This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
The date for a parliamentary session to elect a new Lebanese president was set, but the session was postponed for the sixth time since the Lebanese crisis began. Attesting this crisis is the strike in the middle of Beirut, which has been there for 1 year as of today. The strike was called for by the Secretary General of Hezbollah, Hassan Nasrallah, to pressure the majority to form a national unity government. The year went by quickly and weighed heavily on the shoulders of the Lebanese, changing the characteristics of the capital without achieving its stated objectives. In spite of the political congestion in Lebanon, things are turning in favor of Army General Chief Michel Suleiman. This man might be the awaited president of the country, especially after getting the support of Michel Aoun. This support, however, is based on appointment of Saad Hariri, who is the head of the future party, as prime minister. Will Michel Suleiman finally unite the Lebanese? The following report by correspondent Katia Jamil tries to answer this question.
ما خلا الاحتفالات العسكرية نادراً ما يتكلم العماد ميشيل سليمان عادة لم يخرج عليها.
Aside from speaking at military celebrations, General Michel Suleiman seldom talks, a habit he has kept up with since reaching the highest military position in the country about 9 years ago. Many changes have happened during this time, especially in the past 3 years, with people changing their allegiances and coalitions. But throughout it all, the army general remained neutral with the objective of maintaining the security of the country, which was threatened many times in various ways, thus opening the door of the presidency for him. By equally meeting with people from rival parties and keeping out of the intense political polarization in Lebanon, he got closer to the presidential palace.
ليقترب أكثر إلى القصر الرئاسي.
خيار قائد الجيش لا يعني خيار انتهاء.
The decision about the next army general chief does not mean that the crisis in Lebanon will end. Rather, it will only take a new direction. In other words, the option of a truce will be reopened instead of the political void, which would have certainly led to clashes in the political and security scene in Lebanon.
Michel Suleiman's name had been mentioned previously as a solution for the crisis, so the Lebanese people were not surprised when his name reappeared. They have been living in a vacuum for many years, politically and otherwise.
Honestly, we no longer have anything here. The young people have already left. There is no stability in the country. We hope that the country will become strong with a new president.
If the army general chief wants to become the president of the Lebanese Republic, we welcome him.
But not everyone is feeling welcoming. They fear that sudden changes could happen, ending the Lebanese consensus before it even materializes, and not ending there. A week ago, a Lebanese general left the presidential palace, and a week from now, another general may re-enter. The void between these two generals is like swords aimed at everyone in the country, without exceptions. Katia Jamil, Beirut, Dubai Television.
The results of the Jordanian parliamentary elections dominated the meeting of the Muslim Brotherhood's Consultative Council, which is the executive committee of the organization. The meeting ended with a decision to dissolve the council, which coincided with the Jordanian king's decision to appoint Muslim Brotherhood former Secretary General Abdel Majid Znaibat as a member of the House of Notables.
The Muslim Brotherhood is facing a crisis, but this time the crisis is not with the government, but rather it is an internal one. The parliamentary elections have led to a major defeat for the Islamic Action Front. It won 17 seats in previous elections, but this time it only won 6 seats. The election results overshadowed the organization's leadership, therefore causing the Consultative Council to take a unique step of dissolving itself. This comes after some members voiced criticism of the council's decision to participate in elections.
There was a lot of perjury in the elections, which had a huge influence on the results. This has caused the Muslim Brotherhood's Consultative Council to regret its decision to participate in the elections. Therefore, this body of leadership decided to take the responsibility for their wrong decision by dissolving itself. This decision opens the door for new elections, the formation of a new Consultative Council, and new leadership.
The Muslim Brotherhood is paying the price for two things. First, for not reaching a clear understanding on its relationship with the state and government. Leaders within the organization differ on how it should deal with the government. Second, their performance during the elections.
In an important step, Jordanian King Abdullah II appointed former Muslim Brotherhood Secretary General Abdelmajid Znebat, who is known for his modernization, to the King's Special Cabinet, the House of Notables, which has 55 members.
He did not receive an order from the Muslim Brotherhood to not accept the appointment, but he must have realized that he should not, because the general trend among the organization is to not participate.
The message is that the state does not want to give up its relationship with the Muslim Brotherhood. However, it has specific expectations for how the Muslim Brotherhood's members should conduct their political activities.
The Secretary General for the Islamic Action Front, Zaki bin Rashid, said that the Muslim Brotherhood needs to carefully examine whether they will stay or withdraw from Parliament. Saad al-Sinawi, Al-Arabiya, Amman.
Saad al-Sinawi, Al-Arabiya, Amman.
مساء الخير واهلا وسهلا بكم في برنامج نقاش ياتيكم كالعاده مباشره على قناه فرانس 24.
Good evening. We welcome you to our program نقاش, which as usual is aired directly on France 24. Once again, the most violent riots in France's history were renewed last Sunday after two young immigrants crashed their motorcycle into a police car. This triggered violence in the suburb of Villiers-le-Bel in the Belleur, which spread to other areas. Every night since the incident took place, police stations have been attacked, stores have been robbed, and cars have been burned. This has continued to happen despite the fact that the police opened an investigation into the incident which claimed the lives of the two young men. What makes matters worse is the use of guns by residents in the suburbs who chase every police officer they see. All of this occurred before President Nicolas Sarkozy announced a Marshall Plan for France's suburbs. In the following discussion, we will try to understand the reasons for all these disturbances. Why are some people calling for attacks on the police? What have the French police done to avoid such riots? And what can one do for the people who are not suffering from poverty or hunger and who walk around with cellular phones and fashionable clothes? Does unemployment create violence? And if so, why? Are the riots a result of racism? Although, according to some statistics, France is the least racist country in Europe. In 2005, Sarkozy used the word scum to describe the young men of the suburbs. This time, however, Sarkozy was in China and he did not talk about the suburbs. What can be done to prevent this phenomenon from happening again? Joining us is Tawfiq El-Maklouki, the president of the Pluralist Flans Party, and Khalid Hamidani, a board member of the Assimilation Committee, which provides consultations for the French Prime Minister.
ومع السيد خالد حمداني العضو في المجلس الأعلى للاندماج وهي هيئة استشارية مرتبطة برئاسة الوزراء في فرنسا ومع السيد
We will begin with Tawfiq El-Maklouki. How can one explain the renewal of the phenomena of violence in Paris?
بالنسبة لي لم يقع حل ما حدث من سنتين من أحداث عنف.
In my opinion, there has been no dialogue between the government and the residents of the suburbs since the violence first broke out 2 years ago in France. Some temporary solutions were suggested to stop the situation from deteriorating further. What happened is similar to what firefighters do. They put out the fire for now, and then they think about what to do next. So far, there has been no solution. Promises were made to allocate large funds to solve some of the serious problems in the suburbs. You say that some young men in the suburbs walk around with fashionable clothes and expensive cell phones, but in reality, the problem is not only financial. This is a very serious identity problem that must be discussed. I think today we are living in a state of isolation, like Sarkozy said during the election campaign. Today we have real dialogue and communication problems. The French Republic must open a dialogue with its sons.
انقطاع تواصل وانقطاع حواري حقيقي يجب إعادة الحوار بين الجمهورية وأبنائها.
But how can one explain the phenomena of using violence, which is rarely used in many other European capitals?
Before I answer your question, I want to send my sincere condolences to the families of the two victims and their relatives. This is a 30-year-old problem, and it is hard to solve in 2 or 3 years. In France, there are traffic accidents like this one.
The investigation has not proved that yet.
The investigation will uncover the truth, and I have no doubt that France is a democratic country. Why does a traffic accident lead to violence only in France? Why don't traffic accidents in other European countries cause such violence?
لماذا لا تؤدي إلى تلك الأشياء في دول أخرى؟ هذا سؤال يجب أن يطرح أذن. فإذا قلنا أن المشكل عويص.
حصلت سابقا في.
Similar incidents did occur in Holland, Spain, and Belgium.
بنفس ال.
Did they have the same level of violence as in France?
سوف لا أطيل الكلام.
No, not at the same level.
أخذنا هذا المشكل في تبلور.
I do not want to drag this out. The problem should be addressed within a historical context. During the 50s, 60s, and 70s, immigration policies were not politically motivated. The suburbs that you are talking about have no infrastructure. They are isolated. You can find modernization in the city, which one can see in the civil buildings. We do not find such infrastructure in the suburbs. Also, there is a problem of identity. In the suburbs, young men are asking, are we French?
Child labor is a widespread phenomenon in the Palestinian territories due to the harsh living conditions. According to a 2007 census, youth constitute 50% of the total Palestinian population, 7% of which are involved in child labor. Civil society groups warn of the danger if this phenomenon spreads in Gaza, where some children are forced to leave school to support their families.
بين جنبات هذه الورشة الميكانيكية تبددت ملامح وأحلام.
Scattered in the corners of this mechanics workshop are the childhood dreams of 10-year-old Muhammad. Muhammad left school 2 years ago and screwdrivers and pliers replaced his books and toys. He gets paid a modest amount, about $50 a month. In spite of his young age, he is the only provider in his family of nine. There is no time to play with his friends during his hard day's work.
I left school because of my mother and father. There is no one providing in the house. I have six siblings and my father is sick.
Who chose this job for you?
My mother and father.
Do you like your work? Do you find yourself good at it?
God willing.
Rasha has had her share of hardship and toil as well, but her dreams of living out her childhood and playing with her friends don't leave her mind. She spends the whole day between cars and pedestrians, convincing them or begging them to buy some of what she has for a few extra shekels.
I sell biscuits, yogurt, anything. That's why I don't go to school. We don't have anything. We need vegetables for the house, medicine for my mother, and my sister has asthma, so we need to buy inhalers for her.
Would you like to go to school? What else would you like?
It's my wish to go to school and wear the school uniform like other girls.
Rasha and three of her siblings have been working on the street and the crossroads for 4 years. Her father is absent, her mother is ill, and there is no organization to help her needy family.
I wish my children could go to school, but I can't. Who would provide for us? I was forced to send my children to sell in the streets to support the family. I'm ill and divorced, with no brothers, no mother, and no father, no one, only God.
Child labor might be a phenomenon in several societies, but its spread in Gaza is worrisome. Gaza suffers from economic and social difficulties, with no serious attempts to help these children and curb the phenomena of child labor. The percentage of child labor is approaching 7% in the Palestinian society, where children constitute 52% of the population. Hiba Akilam, Al Jazeera, Gaza, Palestine.
هبة عكيلة الجزيرة غزة فلسطين.
During a press conference after the Legislative Council in Gaza, Ismail Haniyeh said that everyone should take responsibility for the oppressive siege imposed on Gaza. He called on Egypt to reconsider opening the Rafah crossing between Egypt and Gaza for those who are ill and those who are traveling.
The siege on Gaza is oppressive and suffocating. Its negative effects exceeded normal standards. We call on everyone in the Arab and Muslim worlds, as well as globally, to take on a humanitarian responsibility towards the 1.5 million Palestinians who are like prisoners in the Gaza Strip, as well as the rest of the Palestinian people in the West Bank. We call on our brothers in Egypt in particular to reconsider their position on the Rafah crossing point and the importance of opening it for the Palestinian people, those who are ill, those who are traveling, and those who are pilgrims.
The Vice President of the Legislative Council, Dr. Ahmed Bahar, said in a press conference in Gaza that the Council unanimously agreed on passing the right of return law for Palestinian refugees. He described this decision as historic, adding that it will be submitted to President Mahmoud Abbas for his approval.
We unanimously agreed on the right of return bill as was amended, thus making it into a law. It will be submitted to the President for approval, according to the internal regulations of the Legislative Council in Clause 70. This is considered a historic day for the Palestinian people and for the right of return for the Palestinian refugees, God willing.
Meanwhile, many victims of the ongoing conflict, both Israeli and Palestinian, are pessimistic about the chances for the success of the negotiations begun at the regional conference. IBA's Aaron Viner explains.
Much continues to divide Israelis and Palestinians, including Israel's controversial security barrier, constructed to prevent terrorists from infiltrating from the West Bank into the Jewish state. Israel maintains that the barrier, along with a series of IDF checkpoints throughout the West Bank and at entry points into the nation, will keep Israeli citizens safe from attack. Critics say that these restrictions are choking West Bank inhabitants and causing immense suffering. Israeli Ifat alone lost her mother and her five-year-old niece Gal in a Jerusalem suicide bus bombing in June of 2002. Alone has no doubt about the effectiveness of the barrier.
My mother and my niece and the other citizens that were killed that day would be alive if the closure around Ramallah wouldn't have been opened that very morning.
The security fence is also a matter of life and death to Palestinian Radi Abu Ishaq. In 2005, he watched his sick brother Muhammad die at an Israeli checkpoint when soldiers redirected his ambulance to an alternate checkpoint. The Israeli soldiers refused to open the road for us, Abu Ishaq says. The road was closed and they forbid us from letting him through. They said the only way is to take him to a lower checkpoint. We took him to that other checkpoint, and then they said he died. Their pain colors their views of the chances for success at Annapolis. Radi says that the negotiations are only for the cameras, nothing more and nothing less, and that will not lead to any improvement for Palestinians. Alone sees Annapolis as something possibly even more sinister.
This thing is really, I mean, meaningless in the sense of really solving anything, and yet dangerous in the sense of keeping this illusion that we can just sit together and instantly find a solution and make peace.
It's no laughing matter, but for many people living with the Arab-Israeli conflict, humor is helping to ease the tensions. Arab Labor is an award-winning Israeli comedy series poking fun at the stigmas and stereotypes of everyday reality. Our correspondent David Chater spoke to the show's writer about his personal take on the conflict.
In the opening scene, Dad asks Mum to charm the Israeli guards at a checkpoint by greeting them in Hebrew. But the daughter uses the mother tongue. Afterwards, he asks an Israeli friend and colleague how the border guards can always spot he's a Palestinian. Informed it's the car he's driving rather than the deodorant he's wearing, he buys a Rover. Then finds himself treated like a lord. The actor who plays the part showed the episodes to his fellow Palestinian friends in Jaffa. They loved them.
There is something in this that alleviates the day-to-day pressures that they face. And I really believe in comedy because there are so many messages you can get across.
The writer of the series says he's deliberately used black humor because the situation of the Palestinian citizens of Israel is so difficult. Certainly, some of the scenes where the main character tries to insinuate and flatter his way into Jewish life are almost painful to watch.
To fit as a stranger in Israeli society, in a Jewish country, till now it's impossible. I think major things should be changed.
Painful darts of humor are also thrown at Cupid when love tries to cross the divide. The actor who plays the outspoken Palestinian feminist, spurning Israeli advances, thinks it's dangerous territory, but ultimately effective.
Personally, I think laughter is the most, it's the higher sense of criticism. When you want to criticize something, I think bring it in a joke and it's, you know, it stings the most.
Every Palestinian knows being an Israeli Arab is no laughing matter. But if they and their fellow Jewish citizens can laugh at the stereotypes portrayed here, the cast hope it can begin to help heal what is an open wound in this society. David Chater, Al Jazeera, Jerusalem.
Arab nations attend the Annapolis Peace Conference in full force. Is this a show of pan-Arab solidarity with the Palestinians? Or is there another reason that Annapolis became Arabalis? The answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
I don't want to say that I told you so,
But 2 weeks ago, I reported from Jerusalem that both Palestinians and Israelis had low expectations for the Annapolis Peace Conference. And this week, these expectations were met. As a matter of fact, the majority of Palestinians and Israelis believe that the conference was a failure. No major breakthroughs and no major declarations. At times, the Annapolis conference looked like a poor theatrical production. The Saudi foreign minister ducking a handshake from both the Israeli prime minister and foreign minister. President Bush mispronouncing Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas's name. Israeli prime minister Ehud Olmert looking lost on stage, whilst Abbas looked like a little kid just happy to be at the White House. Nevertheless, representatives from 16 Arab countries showed up and sat uncomfortably with the Israeli delegation at Annapolis. The presence of these Arab delegations was designed to give official sanction and support to President Bush's initiative to secure an Israeli-Palestinian peace deal by the end of 2008. However, the general consensus in the Arab world is that this was a charade orchestrated by the U.S. administration to further isolate Iran and perhaps pave the way for attacking it.
We do not have a clear idea about the reason why the Palestinian leadership went there. This is only a waste of time. All the money that they are spending there could be better spent on the Palestinian people. I have been watching the news, but it says nothing clear about the conference. There are no news reports about what will happen to us and how will the conference end the Israeli siege.
I was bemused by various U.S. pundits' analysis. While some attributed Arab governments' attendance to a fear of Iran, others saw it as sincere support for the Palestinians. But could there be another reason? Why were these Arab nations tripping over each other in a bid to make the Annapolis photo op? Why, for a brief period of time, did Annapolis turn into Arabolis? I don't think it was for fear of Iran that drove them to Annapolis. More likely, it was their fear of the United States. They showed up because Bush summoned them. Saudi Arabia and other Gulf countries have an historical dependence on the U.S. to secure and protect their oil rich regimes and cannot afford to say no to the president. Poor countries like Egypt, Jordan, and Yemen are on the U.S. aid dole and couldn't manage without it. Then there is Syria, which opposes Annapolis in principle, but attended to make sure its occupied territory in the Golan Heights was put on the agenda.
It's clear that all countries have intentions to take a step towards peace in the region. God willing, the Golan Heights will be returned to us.
Iraq simply declined the invitation. Could it be because the U.S. is incapable of threatening it? What can the United States do? Invade it again? Or could it be that the Bush administration did not want Iraq to be a reminder to the attendees of the sort of peace the U.S. could bring to the Arab-Israeli front? The two invisible elephants in the room were Iran and Hamas. Without them, peace discussions are a non-starter. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. To learn more about this program or to share your thoughts, visit us at linktv.org/mosaic.
What are you giving this holiday season? Is it this? Or this? Or maybe this? This year, why not make a change? And give your friends and family the world. Now it's easy and meaningful to give the gift of Link TV. Just go to linktv.org or call 1-866-485-8848 to honor those you care about with a tax-deductible gift in their name to Link TV. Choose from one of three designs and have a personalized holiday card sent to everyone on your list. Letting your loved ones know you've made them official sponsors of Television Without Borders. This holiday season, remember peace on earth is possible when we see the world without borders. Happy holidays from Link TV. And don't forget, send your card today.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.